save your life.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, class, and welcome to my lecture. As you already know, the title of today's lecture is Ambition, Fate, and Human Life, a philosophical reading of Nathaniel Hawthorne's The Ambitious Guest. Let me introduce myself first. I am Subroto Bishwash, faculty, Mahadevananda Mahavidyalaya. Today you are going to study this particular short story, which is part of your syllabus of paper 5 or CC5 titled American Literature. In CC5 or paper 5, this short story is there in group B, which is dedicated to fiction. As part of American Literature, CC5 group B fiction, we are going to look at Hawthorne's The Ambitious Guest. Now, if you look at the words and ideas I have used in the title, like ambition, fate, and human life, you can assume my intention that ambition, fate, and human life, the interaction of these, the interaction of ambition, fate, and human life, can actually lead us to an understanding of our existence and the reality in which we live. So before I invite you to contemplate on the interplay of ambition, fate, and human life, and how they can lead us to an understanding of the nature of existence and the reality, I would like to take you to a brief detour down the lens of history, which I believe would complement our understanding of The Ambitious Guest. So I'm going to, with my next slide, taking you to that small detour, and I believe you won't be disappointed, because this small detour down the lens of history is ultimately going us to help understand the short story. Look at this slide. This is a historic site. Look at the picture and the signpost that actually describes the picture. This is a 2018 picture, and as the signpost reads, Crawford Notch State Park, Wiley House Historical Site, New Hampshire Division of Parks. So here the house that you see to the left of the picture is actually the visitors center and the headquarters of that New Hampshire Division of Parks. And I have marked a red circle, which is pointed by a red arrow, that is a small piece of rock. I shall talk about that small piece of rock encircled and pointed by the red arrow. Look at the landscape. There is a mountain, and at the foot of the mountain we have this visitor site and the headquarters of the New Hampshire Division of Parks, or Crawford Notch State Park, the Wiley House Historical Site. This is a historical site, a favorite tourist destination. This is very popular for hiking, picnic, and fishing. So where is it? is in the state of New Hampshire. On the right-hand side of the slide, look at the red arrow. The red arrow is pointing at the state of NH, New Hampshire, United States. And the circle that you see on the map actually marks the northeastern part of United States of America, known as New England. These small states of the northeastern part of United States are known as New England. And among other states of New England, we have North Hampshire. And North Hampshire is going to be important for us. And just below North Hampshire, to the south of North Hampshire, you have Massachusetts. And this is the birthplace of Nathaniel Hawthorne. He was born in 1804 at Salem in Massachusetts. Now, the historical site in the previous slide and the mountain that was there, look at again, is actually the White Mountains, New Hampshire. And it is a very rugged terrain, the White Mountains. It actually covers almost a quarter of the state of New Hampshire and a small part of the state Maine of New England. And it is actually part of the Appalachian Mountains, the Northern American mountain range, Appalachian Mountains, part of that Appalachian Mountains, the White Mountains. And why am I talking about the White Mountains? Because the first photograph of Crawford Notch State Park and Willie House Historical Site, this actually is in the White Mountains. To be more specific, it is in the notch of the White Mountains. What is a notch? A notch is a mountain pass. A mountain pass or a notch is a navigable route through a mountain range or over a ridge. And this White Mountains is quite rugged as part of the Appalachian Mountains, and in fact, the most rugged in New England. And there is a navigable route through that mountain from the east to the west, and vice versa. It is a important, or rather, it was at the time of Hawthorne, and still is an important route. During those days, it was important for the traders. And the navigable route through the White Mountains was that mountain pass, the notch of White Mountains. But look at the first picture with macadamized roads and modern bungalow-like houses. The place was not like this in the past. In the past, say 200 years ago, the place was quite different, as you can fairly assume. And I am talking about late 18th century, in 1790s. In 1790s, a family called the Crawfords came to the White Mountains as one of the pioneers who built several taverns along the mountain pass in order to help the travelers traveling up and down the notch. It was Abel Crawford in 1793 who first came and settled in the White Mountains, to be specific, in the notch of the White Mountain. Later, his son Ethan Crawford carried forward his father's business, and at least three generations of the Crawfords played a vital role in the White Mountains. And today, the notch, that navigable route, is named after that family, Crawford, the Crawfords. Therefore, The White Mountain Notch is called the Crawford Notch. Remember the first picture? Crawford Notch State Park. So Crawford Notch refers to, the name Crawford refers to that first settlers, the Crawfords. So it was back in 1793. This is a painting painted in the 19th century by William Henry Bartlett. It actually depicts a tavern in the Notch of the White Mountains. And the tavern was called Willie House, New Hampshire. It was depicted in 18, it was in this condition in 1820s. From one of the Crawfords, probably, most probably from Ethan Crawford, this particular house, this particular tavern, old tavern, old inn, old public house, was bought by a man named Samuel Willie Jr. Samuel Willie the Jr. in October 1826 bought this old tavern and moved here in right in the middle of the notch of the White Mountain. And this part was the narrowest part of the notch, the narrowest part of the mountain pass. And that is why it was known as the Narrows. In the Narrows, the tavern, the building to the left with the chimney is the tavern, and the other shade on the right hand side is the barn. In 1826, in the month of October, Samuel Willie the Junior, his wife and five children shifted there, and they continued to use the house as a tavern. They used to offer food, drink, and shelter to the travelers traveling up and down the notch. But this was a very dangerous place to live. Look at the steep mountains around. And the house was just at the foot of a mountain with the steep cliff in the behind, and in the front, a river flowing just on the other side of the road. The name of the river was Saco. So this is the small patch of flat ground with the mountains in the behind and the river Saku just on the other side of the road. And the travelers traveling up and down the notch used to stop there, have drinks, food, and rest at night. So initially, there was no problem except the hostile weather and the rugged terrain. But the very next year, in 1826, in the month of July, there was a landslide, and the house narrowly escaped that landslide in June 1826. Though the Willies, Mr. Willie, Mrs. Willie, and their five children were afraid, but they did not pay much attention to that sudden landslide, and they thought that probably those were very rare accidents, and naturally in the future no such thing would happen again. Further, they also arranged a safe place near their tavern so that they could retreat in case there was another slide in future. But 2 months later, the premonition that was there in the month of June proved to be fatal in the month of August. On 28th August 1826, a heavy downpour made the river Saco swell, and the torrential downpour also caused a massive landslide in the mountain. And In front of the house, there was river Sakho swelling angrily. So the family therefore wanted to find a safe place. There was that landslide and there was the river swelling. So they left their house and wanted to take shelter in that safe place they had built. But unfortunately, and what a irony of fate, while escaping that danger, they actually stepped right in front of it. They all got buried under the landslide. And no trace of their dead bodies could be found. There are other accounts, other varying accounts. Some of them say that they got drowned and carried away by the current of the river Sakho. Other accounts say that they got buried under the landslide. But whatever the cause may be, the incident was nevertheless very tragic. And more so because not a single window of the Wheely house was damaged by the landslide. It stood utterly unaffected, untouched by the landslide. So it is quite clear that had they been waiting inside their own house, inside the comfort of their own house, they could definitely leave. But they wanted to get to that safe place, mistakenly considering their house to be unsafe. But that a seemingly unsafe house was left untouched by the landslide, and the safe place that they had built was totally buried and underneath those wheelies, seven wheelies, along with two of their workers, two of their hired men got buried. And how did the Wheely house was standing without any damage done to it? Because just behind the house there was a piece of rock hanging over the cliff, and that piece of rock hanging down the cliff actually splitted the stream of the landslide into two. And thus, the streams of that landslide got splitted and came round the house, leaving the house unaffected, untouched, and leading to the tragedy. And this incident, because of the death of a young family, secondly, because of the rugged terrain, mysterious and somewhat gothic surroundings, and lastly the cruel twist of fate with the house untouched and the dwellers all buried alive, this incident made headlines in newspapers and magazines, and thus became almost like a local lore, a legend. And not only did it make headlines in newspapers and magazines, it drew attention of tourists. Tourists started flocking to have a look at the Wheely house because it was believed to be a mystery, a cruel twist of fate. The house standing unaffected with the dwellers buried alive. And thus several taverns and hotels got built in different places of the notch to accommodate those travelers who started flocking the place. And even the brother of Mr. Wheely Benjamin Willey capitalized on this incident by charging the travelers for a guided tour around the house. And this incident also drew the attention of the artists and authors, and a group of painters started depicting the rugged and gothic landscape of the White Mountains, and they came to be known as the White Mountain Artists. Look at this painting. This is a view of the mountain pass called the Notch of the White Mountains, Crawford Notch, painted in 1839 while on canvas by American artist Thomas Cole. The cultural impact of the Willey family tragedy was immense. So a group of painters also came flocking, depicting the landscape, and thus the White Mountain painters came to exist. And there were also authors writing poems, stories on that incident. In 1835, Nathaniel Hawthorne wrote and published a story based on this Willey family tragedy. In the month of June, he published his story based on Willey family tragedy in the New England magazine, titled The Ambitious Guest. He, of course, fictionalized that historical incident of Willey family tragedy, introduced an imaginary guest, and thus, with the help of that narrative, tried to understand the interplay of ambition, fate, and human life with his attempt to grasp the meaning of existence and reality. Now, what happened to the house? Let me briefly tell you. In 1845, a three-story hotel was built right next to the Willey house, and people continued to visit that place. It became the local lore, the legend, and also because of the cultural impact, the White Mountain painters, the authors treating the Willey family tragedy in poems and fiction. And that continued for the entire 19th century till in 1899, due to a faulty chimney, the Willey house and the hotel adjacent to it got burnt down. And today, the house that I showed in the very first slide, the visitor center and the headquarters of Crawford Notch State Park, that buildings were built much later, and the site of that tragedy is marked by that small piece of rock. Remember the first slide, there was a red circle pointed by a red arrow. This is that rock, the landslide 1826. Site of the Willey house, the rock that commemorates the cultural legend. The rock is placed there, right at the place where the Willey house stood, for the visitors to have a look. But it got burnt down in 1899 in fire due to a faulty chimney, and today the state park has put this rock there. And this is Hawthorne, who in 1835 published the story in the New England magazine, which later got republished in the second volume of Twice Told Tales in 1841. And Hawthorne, as you see from this slide, was born in 1804 and lived till 1864. So when he wrote and published The Ambitious Guest, he was quite a young and somewhat obscure author. He was yet to achieve his fame. Actually, he had to wait till 1850 for the publication of the Scarlet Letter to enjoy his fame. But till then, a young, obscure fiction writer, using the Wheelie family tragedy to write his short story, The Ambitious Guest. An author is known for his allegorical and symbolic tale, one of the greatest fiction writers of America. And he actually worked during the phase of American writing or American literature that later came to be called the American Renaissance, that is from 1830s to the end of the American Civil War in 1865. That was the period when, in the wake of the Romantic movement, American literature came of age as an expression of a national spirit. But here we shall look at the story only, with our attempt to understand Hawthorne's understanding of ambition, fate, and human life. The Ambitious Guest. So I have quoted these two sentences from the short story. Just have a look at the sentences. Is not the kindred of a common fate a closer tie than that of birth? So this is told of the ambitious guest and the dwellers of the Wheelie house, of the tavern. But remember, in the ambitious guest, Hawthorne actually leaves all the characters anonymous. We have the eponymous guest as an ambitious guest, but we do not get his name like the rest of the members of the family. So thus, though the incident as narrated in the short story resembles the historical Wheelie family tragedy, Hawthorne consciously avoids naming his characters because it was not necessary to name the characters in the aftermath of that landslide. People of New England knew very well that the incident that Hawthorne is describing in the short story is definitely the Wheelie family tragedy, because it became so famous and so well known. Therefore, the reader reading The Ambitious Guest in 1835 is well aware of the incident which the story is based on. Therefore, there was no such element of hidden suspense, because the outcome was already known to the 1835 reader of New England. They all knew what would happen to the ambitious guest along with the family, because the story became well known. It became a local lore, a legend. So this is told of the fate of the ambitious guest. He was totally the work of Hawthorne's imagination. Alas, they had quitted their security and fled right into the path of destruction. This refers to the final tragedy. They had quitted their security, they had left their house, which was left untouched by the slide, and fled right into the path of destruction. And if you look at the story, it is a fictionalized account of that fateful night of the 28th of August 1826. But if you look at the story, it talks about a September night. That is, of course, Hawthorne's imagination. But historically speaking, the fateful night of August 28, 1826 has been fictionalized here in this narrative. And through the unnamed guest, we have a glimpse into the nature of human ambition and the intervention of fate, and thus the true nature of human life and existence. And as the historical account has already made it quite clear, that it can be called an irony of fate. The uncertainty and futility of worldly fame and our existence would be contemplated. And we shall see how. I have highlighted portions from the text to share with you after I finish this slide. So we are going to have a philosophical probing into the text. Is my text visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I have zoomed in and highlighted some sections from the text, because it is not possible for us to finish the entire text. So I would invite you to read just the zoomed in and highlighted sections in order to have that understanding of life and existence. So on September night, a family had gathered round their hearth. So it starts with a cozy family setting. But never forget the harsh and adverse terrain where the house was situated. So the next very moment, that gothic and harsh atmosphere surrounding the cozy family would be described. I read from the text. This family were situated in the notch of the White Hills, where the wind was sharp throughout the year and pitilessly cold in the winter, giving their cottage all its fresh inclemency before it descended on the valley of the Saco. They dwelt in a cold spot and a dangerous one. So look at the expression, they dwelt in a cold spot and a dangerous one. For a mountain towered above their heads, so steep that the stones would often rumble down its sides and startle them at night. And I forgot to tell you one thing. I showed you the house and the mountain behind it. The mountain behind it, some 4,000 meter high, later came to be named after the Wheely family, and it called Mount Wheely. So today, if you search on the internet, you will find Mount Wheely. That was the mountain stood right behind the Wheely house, named after the Wheely family. Next, when the wind came through the notch and seemed to pause before their cottage, rattling the door with a sound of wailing and lamentation before it passed into the valley. Look at the description. Immediately after the description of the family sitting comfortably round the hearth, we get a description of the cold and dangerous spot where they lived. And look at the way the wind has been described, like a monster rattling and threatening. Thus, a gothic atmosphere is created. Gothic would mean an atmosphere of horror, mystery, and to some extent, supernatural also. But the notch was very important. The mountain pass was important. That is why Wheely family shifted there to run their tavern. Look at the importance of the pass. The romantic pass of the notch is a great artery through which the lifeblood of internal commerce is continually throbbing between Maine on one side and the Green Mountains and the shores of the St. Lawrence on the other. So therefore, they had to stay there. Now, the very next moment in the narrative, we see the appearance of a stranger, a guest who has come to spend the night at the tavern run by the Wheelies. To look at this section, when the footsteps were heard, therefore, between the outer door and the inner one, the whole family rose up, grandmother, children, and all, as if about to welcome someone who belonged to them and whose fate was linked with theirs. Look at the bold section, whose fate was linked with theirs. So these are premonitions, because there was nothing to hide from the readers. In 1835, each and every reader of New England was aware of the 1826 landslide. So there was nothing to hide for the sake of suspense. But here we have that premonition whose fate was linked with theirs. The fate of the traveler was linked with the doomed fate of the Wheelies. The door was opened by a young man. So this is the appearance of the eponymous character, the unnamed guest. Immediately after the entrance of the guest, something strange happened. What happened? The frank-hearted stranger had just drawn his chair to the fire when something like a heavy footstep was heard without, rushing down the steep side of the mountain, as with long and rapid strides, and taking such a leap in passing the cottage as to strike the opposite precipice. So look at the description. It almost sounds like a monster coming down the mountain, doesn't it? Heavy footstep was heard without, rushing down the steep side of the mountain, as with long and rapid strides, and taking such a leap in passing the cottage as to strike the opposite precipice. The family held their breath because they knew the sound, and their guest held his by instinct. So this is the way the Gothic atmosphere is created, in order to prepare the ground for the intervention of fate. The old mountain has thrown a stone at us for fear we should forget him, said the landlord, recovering himself. So it was a mountain, it was a rock rolling down the mountain. He sometimes nods his head and threatens to come down. So that is the danger of living in such a place. Now the guest or traveler starts sharing his view of life, his aim in life. And while doing so, we have this comment made by Hawthorne: is not the kindred of a common fate a closer tie than that of birth? So fate actually, common fate is actually a closer bond than that of birth. The secret of the young man's character was a high and abstracted ambition. He could have born to live an undistinguished life, but not to be forgotten in grave. This is the characteristics of our guest. Very ambitious. He actually wants fame, and he wants earthly, he craves for, he yearns for earthly immortality. He doesn't want to end his life without achieving something. So look at his attitude. He is always focused on the future. The present is not so important for him, nor is the past. The future is very important for him. He is going to achieve something in future so that he can be live forever in the hearts of his countrymen. Look at his wish. But I cannot die till I have achieved my destiny. Then let death come, I shall have built my monument. So thus he unravels his ambition, making the rest of the members of the family, revealing their wish one after another. The father says, I wish to own a farm away from these threatening white mountains. One of the children of the Willis also adds to this kind of making wishes. It says that, well, I wish to go out right in the middle of the night to drink from the river that flows nearby. The grandmother also expresses her wish by saying that, I wish to have my clean and neat burial with my shroud properly arranged. Thus, one after another, they make their wishes, influenced by the wish made by the ambitious guest. But suddenly, while they were exchanging their future plans, exchanging their ambitions, exchanging their wishes, and the weather outside started conspiring against the dwellers of the Willy house. There was a wail along the road as if a funeral were passing, for the wind turned violent. Now look at the last portion. While thus exchanging thoughts and wishes, for a moment it was the last section that actually leads us to the calamity. For a moment, the old woman's ghastly conception so engrossed the minds of her hearers that a sound abroad in the night, rising like the roar of a blast, had grown broad, deep, and terrible before the fated group were conscious of it. The house and all within it trembled. The foundations of the earth seemed to be shaken, as if this awful sound were the peal of the last trump. Young and old exchanged one wild glance and remained an instant, pale, affrighted, without utterance or power to move. Then the same shriek burst simultaneously from all their lips. The slide, the slide. The simplest words must intimate, but not portray, the unutterable horror of the catastrophe. The victims rushed from their cottage and sought refuge in what they deemed a safer spot, where, in contemplation of such an emergency, a sort of barrier had been reared. Alas, they had quitted their security and fled right into the pathway of destruction. The story has been told far and wide and will forever be a legend of these mountains. Poets have sung their fate. So this story has been very popular, and it would forever be a legend of the White Mountains. And poets have sung their fate. So it is a cruel twist of fate that actually made the story so popular. And thus the closing comments: his name and person utterly unknown, his history, his way of life, his plans, a mystery never to be solved. So the anonymous guest, along with the anonymous hosts of the house, got buried alive, and thus the story ends. So what do we get from the story? We, from the very title, get the idea of ambition. is ambition good, or is it something we should consider with suspicion? Because in our materialistic way of pursuing goals in our lives, ambition is believed to be something that would help us achieve those goals in life. But ambitions, actually, in the philosophical context, in the context of art and literature, is something ambiguous. And philosophers, artists, authors have a kind of ambivalent attitude towards ambition, because they are always aware of the flip side of ambition. The flip side of ambition is tragic fall. You must have all read the tragic fall of Macbeth, who was very ambitious, and especially with the European Renaissance, the notion of ambition and the flip side of ambition, the ambivalent attitude towards ambition, started developing among the philosophers and artists. We have another ambitious figure, the character of Icarus from the classical myth, who was ambitious of flying high in the sky and got drowned in the sea as the heat of the sun caused his waxen wings melt. We have Dr. Faustus, known for his lust for or ambition for knowledge, and sold his soul to the devil. We have Satan in the Bible, so ambitious that he revolted against his own creator, and thus all got doomed. So ambition, therefore, in art and literature has therefore always been treated with suspicion. Though in our day-to-day life, we always try to get motivated, try to motivate one another by encouraging them to cherish ambition. But the flip side of ambition should always be kept in mind, because ambition, if unfulfilled or even fulfilled for a brief moment of time, it can lead to disaster. Think of numerous suicides, ambitious youths committing suicide when they fail to reach their goal, when they fail to reach ambition. But life is greater than ambition. Life is greater than any worldly goal. So this notion, this basic understanding of life, if missing in ambition, then the person is doomed. In case of the ambitious guest, he actually missed that point. He actually considered ambition to be greater than life. Ambition is not greater than life. Ambition may be part of life. The part of life cannot be equated with the whole of life. If you make part of life the whole of life, then you are going to suffer. And he always thought of the future, what he would achieve, how would people treat him after his death. So always thinking of the future, ignoring the present moment, which is the gift. There is a movie, animated film, Kung Fu Panda. In that Kung Fu Panda, there is the master, Kung Fu master, Ugwe. Ugwe, jodi tora onekei dekhe thakbi movie ta, Ugwe, master Shifu shonge conversation e bolche je, the past is history, tomorrow is a mystery, but today is a gift. That's why it is called present. So today is a gift, that's why it's called a present. You can only have control over today. You can't change your past, nor can you be certain of the future, because the only certainty in life is uncertainty. If you fail to see that the only certainty of life is uncertainty, then we are going to live an unfulfilled life, a miserable life. And again, we are then going to blame on or curse on fate, because fate is also another favorite topic for philosophers, authors. You have all read about King Oedipus and how the more he tried to escape his fate, the nearer he got to it. And even we have fatalistic utterance in Shakespeare's King Lear, as flies to the wanton boys, are we to the gods? They kill us for their sport. If you think of the tragic death of the Willies, along with, so for not Willies, because we cannot call them Willies, and Hawthorne choose to keep them anonymous. So the anonymous hosts and the eponymous guest, if you think of their death, you can actually, you may feel like, as flies to wanton boys, are we to the gods? They kill us for their sport. So if you are fatalistic, you may have such a view of life, because you are always ambitious of something more. And ambitious persons or ambition depends on the exposure that we have. If someone is exposed to the game of cricket, then his ambition would be to become a batsman like Sachin. If someone is exposed to, say, politics, then he would have ambition to become the prime minister. If someone is exposed to some other things, then he would excel in that field. So ambition actually is nothing constant, nothing universal. It is actually arbitrary depending on your exposure in life. And when you fail to achieve it, when you consider it greater than life, when you consider it the whole of life, you suffer. And there is this element of fate. So then what is human life? Human life, therefore, is something that should be treated with the consciousness of the fact that the only certainty is uncertainty, and we should enjoy the present without mourning the past, or either fearing or, say, dreaming of the future. But it is indeed a complex reality that we, the humans, find ourselves in. This is the nature of the existence. Therefore, like Hamlet, Shakespeare's Hamlet, we can just say, what a piece of work is man? So this is really a mystery. And if it is a riddle, it is so seemingly hopeless. Why seemingly hopeless? Because everything is uncertain. So amid this seemingly hopelessness, how could you find meaning in life? How could we move forward? Probably we can find meaning by becoming thankful, by becoming grateful. If we become thankful to life, grateful to life, and cherish what we have and try to share those with the people who matters to who sorry who matter to us, then only probably we can find something meaningful. So with this reading of the ambitious guest, we can find this message that ambition, fate, and human life, the interplay of these things, can actually lead us to an understanding of the reality or the nature of our existence, which actually have meaning only in our gratefulness, only in our thankfulness. So with this, I would like to stop. And if you have any question, or if you want to add anything, or if you want to comment, you can just unmute yourself and do so, or you can just put down your question in the chat box. So that I can answer. Anything that you wish to add, or you wish to agree or disagree with me, or you wish to ask? You can have your own opinion, you can share it with others. Srijita has a question. Isn't it so that our ambition helps us to live? Yes, Srijita, it is true, but it also kills. Think of the depressed students who are committing suicide. Don't you think that they are ambitious? And don't you think that ambition is ultimately killing them? So you have to pursue ambition with the consciousness, not considering it to be the whole of your life. And of course, I am not a philosopher, nor I am a moral teacher. So I am a common man like you. So what you know of life is the understanding of life that I also have. But I personally feel that, yes, ambition is needed, but it should be treated as a small part of life, not the whole of life. It is not larger than life. It is not more than your life. And you should not always think of future. If you always think of future, afraid of future, or dream of future, then you would forget to live in the present. You would ignore the present. Om Singh has a question. Sir, does through the ambitious guest, the author is hinting towards the damnation caused by ambition? Actually, Om, as I have said, authors, philosophers have very ambivalent attitude towards ambition, a kind of love-hate relationship with ambition. So you cannot totally blame ambition, nor can you call it a pure virtue. There is that ambivalence in it. So yes, as I have talked about the tragic heroes, Macbeth, Icarus, Faustus, Satan, they were all the victims of ambition. So here, in this case, the ambitious guest was not such a victim, because he is not like a tragic hero. But he actually considered ambition to be greater than life. And therefore, his death appears to be a cruel irony of fate. But yes, author is, of course, suspicious of ambition, you can say that. And ekhane jodio the ambitious guest, the character cannot be called a tragic hero, but interestingly, the narrative resembles the pattern of classical tragedy. How? You have here the three unities maintained: the unity of time, the unity of place, the unity of action. Unity of time, the actual time of events has been narrated throughout the narrative. So there is no jump or lapse in time. The actual time taken by the narrative is the actual time of action. Just unity of time, unity of place, the Crawford notch, same place, there is no shift of setting. Unity of action, a single plot handled by the author without any diversion. And look at the story itself. The readers in 1835 were all aware of the Wheelie family tragedy. So when they are reading the story, reading the wish of the guest, they are actually behaving like chorus. Jitara shob jane, and they are unable to warn. And they are trying to warn the guest, je, beware child, what you wish for. Karan, 1835, a person reading the story already knew the Wheelie family tragedy. So he is like omniscient, like the chorus. And viewing the action played before his or her eyes, and unable to intervene, he can only comment, she can only comment. And we have the interplay of fate, as in classical tragedy, and ambition at the center, and that suspicion of the author towards ambition. So I hope there is no more question, and we are done. So with the permission of my host Auditro, I would like to take my leave. So Auditro, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
For helping me throughout.
And there are no questions in YouTube live chat also. I have checked thoroughly. And
okay, thank you.
So, sir, I think there is a question.
Okay, Bornali Bodu was, sir, the ambitions of the guest do not have direct role in his death. Why is ambition playing the role of villain? Actually, ambition is not a villain. I am repeatedly reminding you that we should conscious of the ambivalent attitude, the love-hate kind of relationship that the author shares with ambition. So you cannot call it a villain. You can call the attitude of the guest wrong. The guest is living in the future, ignoring the present. He always wants to contemplate on the future, and he ignores that life should be lived in the present, and he believes ambition to be greater than life. যে জীবন চলে যাক, আই ওয়ান্ট টু হ্যাভ ইমর্টালিটি। সো দ্যাট কাইন্ড অফ অ্যাটিটিউড অফ লাইফ, ইফ ইউ ওয়ান্ট টু বি রিমেম্বার্ড আফটার ইয়োর ডেথ, সো ইউ আর অলওয়েজ থিঙ্কিং অফ দ্য পিরিয়ড আফটার ইয়োর ডেথ, যে আমি মরে যাওয়ার পর যেন আমাকে সবাই মনে রাখে, আমি মরে যাওয়ার পর সবাই যেন আমাকে ধন্য ধন্য করে। সো ইউ আর অলওয়েজ ফোকাসিং অন দ্য টাইম আফটার ইয়োর ডেথ। সো হোয়াট ইজ দ্য পারপাস অফ ইয়োর লাইফ দেন? তাহলে বেঁচে থাকার তো কোনো মানে দরকার নেই। তাহলে ঠিক আছে, ইউ ডাই at this very moment and you would be remembered. And ironically, we all remember the ambitious guest. So, to ichhe chilo otai to je oke sobai mone rakhbe, oke sobai ekta jayga debe sobar mone, to amra jayga dicchi, jayga diyechi, so his ambition is fulfilled. But if you love life, you cannot always think of the future, you should live in the present. And thus ambition should not be blamed like a villain. We should all have that ambivalent, we should all be conscious of that ambivalent attitude towards ambition, because I am continuously saying that it may be a part of life, it has a role to play in our life, but if you make it the whole of life, then there will be problem. Ar oto ambition fulfill holo to amra oke mone rakhlam. So ironically, fate actually answered. কৌস্তভ স্যার, আমাদের পাস্ট কি আমাদের প্রেজেন্ট অ্যান্ড ফিউচারকেও এফেক্ট করে? ডাজ ইট অলওয়েজ হ্যাপেন? কৌস্তভ, দিজ আর অল ফিলোসফিক্যাল কোয়েশ্চেন্স অ্যান্ড আই এম নট কম্পিটেন্ট এনাফ টু আনসার সাচ প্রোফাউন্ড ফিলোসফিক্যাল কোয়েশ্চেন্স। উই আর অনলি হিয়ার টু এক্সামিন দ্য অ্যাম্বিশিয়াস গেস্ট অ্যান্ড হাউ অ্যাম্বিশন, ফেট অ্যান্ড হিউম্যান লাইফ ইন্টার হ্যাভ রোলস টু প্লে in this short story. Past ki amader present and future keo affect kore na, maybe kore, obviously kore, seta to kore na ta noy, but if you forget the present, ami etai bolchi bar bar je you have control over the present, you cannot alter your past, you cannot have control over your future because it is uncertain. Tale since you have control over your present, that should be the most important aspect for you. Maybe you can have the past in mind, you cannot forget it, but it should not be, if you always live in the past or if you try to live in the future, probably then you are making a mistake. So I hope
so
I have answered.
Then I am closing the live stream.
Okay. So thank you, class. Again, thank you, Auditro.
Most welcome, sir.